Hannah. Okay, so it's really great to be with you guys. I'm actually from Kansas. So I came from Kansas to Ohio. It's really fun. Every time I say I'm from Kansas, how many of you got this little image of like Dorothy and Toto just like flew into your head? Yes? Okay, good. I'm gonna rock some sparkly red shoes at some point, I'm sure. So, but I'm from Kansas, and all the guys last night got to like show off their phenomenal families. How adorable was that, right? And so I don't know about you, when I hear someone speak, it's true. You're like, who are you? Where are you from? Like, what are you about? So you can learn a lot about me in like 3 slides. So here we go. This is the first slide. This is my awesome, oh, sorry, I'm going fast. This is my awesome husband. It's so fun. His name, our last name is Swafford. So it's funny, like since he was 5 years old, people just call him Swaff. And so he's a theology professor at Benedictine College where we live in Atchison. Yes. And so people call him Doc Swaff or like Swaff Daddy or P. Diddy Swaff or whatever. People call me Swaff or Swaff Mama, which I think is more fun. So like if I accidentally say Swaff, I'm talking about this guy. It's always fun. I put this slide up and all the girls are like, dang, Sarah, he's cute. It's like, I'm aware. He's an extremely good looking man, right? So we've been married for 11 years. So he is fantastic. I wish he was here for y'all to hang out with him. So, and he is very cute, but not quite as cute as these people. So these are my 4 children. So I know I look 12, but I did birth them all. So this is my family. This is Thomas. He's 10. Any eldest children out in the crowd? Oh. Your mom loves you. Thank you for being so helpful. She loves you, right? Like, Thomas is my helper. He's my main man. This is Fulton. Any Archbishop Fulton Sheen fans in the house? Yeah? If you don't know him, get to know him. This is Fulton. He's 9. And this is Miss Kate. Kate is 5. Kate's going straight to the convent. She's very excited about it. She discerned that, and we're very happy for her. So, no. Kate, any only girls in the crowd? Are you the only girl in your family? Yes, girls rule the world. Thank you. Yes, Kate is in charge. So, and then this is baby Colby. So Colby is my, isn't he just edible? You can just like pop him in your mouth, right? Just like pop. Colby's my birthday. Colby Joseph is my birthday baby. I had him on my birthday last year, May 12th. So yeah, I was like the whole day, I was like, okay, Jesus, I think he should have his own birthday. And he came at 9:45. So I was like, nope, just kidding. You're with me, kid. So I'm just going to move over to Mother's Day, and it's going to be fantastic. So, but Colby, he's the man. He's just precious. So he's at 14 months. So this is my family. And so I bring this picture to show you, like, I'm just a stay-at-home mom from Kansas. And when I'm not hanging out with these cool people, like, I love being with you all. And I show this picture because everyone, like, sees it and they're like, oh my gosh, your family is so sweet. It's like, thank you. It was like 40 degrees out. Everyone was mad at each other. And that's not even Colby's head. It was swapped out. Like this is real life, people. We do not look like a Ralph Lauren commercial. Like that was like one of the worst days of my life, right? Try getting everybody to take a picture. Like the wind was blowing so hard, we all had like tears streaming down and snot streaming down our faces. Have you guys ever had that experience where it's like 45 degrees out? Like, look what editing can do. Photoshop, thank you. We love you, right? Like, this is not real life. Like, this is not my real life. If you, like, I would love to take this women's session straight to my kitchen around my island and make a triple batch of cookie dough, and we will just have that party there because that is real life, right? Like, that's where the women's session should be. And I tell you this because I really have found, you know, a couple years back, I actually was a dorm mom. Do you guys know, like, a residence hall director at Benedictine? So Swaff and Thomas and Fulton were both, like, babies. But we lived in a college dorm for 3 years. And I took care of 142 freshman college women for 3 years. And everyone says, oh, so you got to know the women really well. It's like, uh-huh. And where there are 142 women, there are at least 142 men, right? So I knew the men and the women super well. You know, guys would come to SWAF, guys would come to me, women, men, couples. And we were just trying to figure out this thing called life. And I had my couch, and I always called it my therapy couch. And I would just lay people out, and I would just spoon feed them cookie dough and be like, it's going to be okay. It's going to be okay. Like, I swear, right? Because I don't know how you're doing it. I don't know how you're doing it right now in this world, in this time. How you're battling everything that you're battling. I'm so impressed at the fight that you're putting up. I remember I was in the RA office one time and all the girls were huddled around this computer and I was like, what's going on? I like walked in and they were like, Sarah, look at this. I'm like, what? And I'll never forget this RA. She turns around and she goes, it's called Facebook. And I was like, ooh. So they like signed me up for it. And that was, I mean, when I was in the dorms is when social media came out. So I went through like junior high, high school, college, dating, engagement, got married before I even knew social media exists. I didn't send my first text until I sent it in the dorms to one of my RAs. And you're all sitting there like, oh my gosh, like how old is she really? She looks good for 55. Like she looks really good, right? Like I'm 33, right? Not 83. But like, you all thought I was 55, didn't you? Okay, good. No. So I don't know how you're doing it. I don't know. I mean, I was a hot mess in junior high and high school, and I didn't even have a phone. Like, I don't even know how you're doing it because the world likes to mess with you. Amen? I call it the world's idea perfect. Like, I don't have to explain it to you because you already know what I'm talking about, but the world's idea perfect for women, right? What is it? You have to be like size -2, you know, right? Like big doe eyes, like, right? Like big hair, full lips, big hips, long legs, long neck, great brows, perfect teeth, thigh gap, right? Like that's pretty much where we are right now. And that you can rank them in different orders of what's important to you, but they better all be on the list, right? You have to have like the perfect profile picture of all your friends. Cover photo, trophy boyfriend on one arm. All the girls want to be you, all the guys want to be with you, and everybody knows it. It's the world's idea perfect, right? If you can't figure it out, Pinterest has at least 1,000 videos to help you figure out how to look, right? I don't know what I would do without Pinterest. I love it. I couldn't cook, that's for sure. Okay, so like, we know. Thank you, world, we got it. For the men, the world's idea perfect for men, what does it look like? I get this image of like a rapper in a white tux with a gold grill and shades. And he's like standing on a car, always. And there's like cash raining from the sky and like women crawling up his legs, right? And he's just standing there like this. It's Pitbull, let's be real people, right? Like, what do the men have to be? Chiseled and charming, successful at everything they touch. They can be athletic or musical or artistic, it doesn't matter. Like, but you better be something and you better not fail, right? Their cover photo, their profile picture is very important too. Trophy girlfriend on one arm. All the guys want to be them, all the girls want to be with them, and everyone knows it, but nobody talks about it because it's the world's idea perfect, and we play the game, but we don't want to admit it. Life's about taking the perfect picture in the perfect place at the perfect time so you can edit it, filter it, and post it. And guess what? It doesn't stop when you graduate high school, and it doesn't stop when you graduate college, and it doesn't stop when you go get your first job. I helped my 83-year-old grandma pick out her profile picture. It took like 30 minutes. Right? Does it stop? No, you graduate, you move on. All the moms in this room will tell you the world's idea perfect and the pressure that you feel to be perfect according to the world will be with you forever. So we might as well call it out for what it is. Someday it's gonna be about what kind of house you have and what kind of car you drive and how clean your children are and how clean your kitchen are and how clean your kitchen is and how perfect you can keep everything together. It just translates as you go through life. It translates. So we have to call it out, amen? Tell me, are men and women a little bit different? Good, so you're with me, right? I love this, because like when I get to give a talk to men and women, it's funny, because I always ask the men, I'm like, men, are women a little bit like emotional or a little bit hard to understand or a little bit complicating or a little bit confusing? And they're always like, yeah, just a little bit, right? They're like, who is close enough to elbow me in the face, right? But they're like, yeah, women are a little bit hard for us, right? Men and women can miss each other sometimes, right? So I always ask the women, I'm like, women, do men care? Oh, you guys are so nice. Look at you. You're like, they're not even here, but I can't say that. I don't want to talk bad about them, right? Like, do men care? I love this. Sometimes when I travel around, I'm always like, do men care? And girls are like, no, no men care. I'm going to die alone with 100 cats, right? I can't find a good guy anywhere. My grandma swears they're out there, but I haven't seen them, right? Men and women miss each other sometimes. So you have the world's idea of perfect breathing down your neck. You have this pressure to not only be with someone, but to be someone. The pressure to date, the pressure to be all things to all people at all times. And all of a sudden, it just comes like crashing down on you. And then you're looking at the guys like, I don't even know where to start with you. And the guys are looking at you like, I'm just gonna walk away slowly, right? Like, amen? So what do we do? I always love to kind of take the men. I call it, you know, like, it would help if the men could, like, take a little tour, you know, into the heart and mind of a woman. Wouldn't that help? Like, that would just help. Like, buckle up, ladies, right? Like, I know this is scary, but it's helpful for us to, like, show them, I'm really sorry, but this is just a thing, right? So tell me if you relate to this. It's a typical Friday night, right? You got all your best girlfriends with you, right? Chick flick movie marathon, right? Sweats, always appropriate at all times, right? Sweats, your hoodie footy, like leopard, zebra, whatever, pink, black, love it all, right? You have your box of Little Debbies. I mean both boxes of Little Debbies. Let's be real, people. We're not sharing, right? And it takes you 3 hours to figure out which three movies you're gonna watch, but we finally figured it out, right? Okay, so it's like game on. You throw the first chick flick on, you're like, yes! Like, why do we not do this every night? What? Why? Like, we should do this every night, right? And then, like, the credits roll, you throw on the second one, my personal favorite, like, Bad Boy Goes Altar Boy Part 2, the musical. Fantastic. So, like, that one rolls, and, like, the credits roll, and you sit there, and you're like, well, my life is officially worthless. Okay, good. Let's do it again, right? So it's like 2 a.m, and you're going for, you know, movie number 3, because like I always tell the guys, women don't watch chick flicks. Like, we are the main character. Like, we are one with her. For like 1 hour and 48 minutes, like, we are her, right? I know they ride horses and slay dragons in their mind too, but we won't talk about it. Okay, good. So like, you know, like, we're one with her. And so finally, movie 3 rolls, and like, there goes the credits, and like the blue screen comes up, and everyone just sits. And then all of a sudden, you stand up, and you pick up your remote control, you chuck it against the wall, and you're like, when's it gonna be my turn? I am so sick and tired of waiting for Mr. Right, Mr. Perfect to walk into my life. I need a cute guy and a horse and a sunset right now. Right? Yes? So what do? You like vent, and you like stress, and you vent, and you talk about him and him and him and this and this and this, and it's like 4:30. You've started another box of Oreos, and like, it's just, we're just done with life for a while, right? And you fall asleep bitter and frustrated and completely out of oatmeal cream pies, and you wake up the next morning and you're like, I'm gonna do this, I'm gonna get through this, but every playlist doesn't help. And you finally get around to Monday morning, and you're walking the halls, or you're walking around your work, or you're walking wherever you walk, and there's a guy that you're like halfway attracted to, and he's like, hey, and you're like, hey, I want you, right? So what do? Well, naturally, you start mentally stalking him. So, right? Thank you. I usually tell the guys, like, when I put up this little mentally stalking screen, I always tell the guys, I'm like, awkward giggling means it's true. Like, you all just cheered. So, like, I think we're gonna go with guilty, right? Okay, good. So like mentally stalking, guys always look at me, they're like, I don't even have a definition, but I'm a little bit creeped out, right? Like, okay, mental stalking, right? You think about like where he's gonna take you on your first date and how he's gonna propose, and like you have the dress and the cake and the invites, like they're all like Pinterest on a secret, not so secret board. He can just like, you know, push play and go, right? And you lovingly do what I call the Christmas card test, right? Where you take like your first name and his last name and make sure it sounds good, because you cannot be too careful. And like every baby name you've ever loved, right? Just like, all 45 of them, right? So like, you know, like you just can't be too careful. And then after you finish mental stalking-ish, you move to social media stalking, amen, right? Social media stalking. So you jump on, you know, pick your poison, pick your favorite, you know, Instagram, Twitter, Snapchat. You look at 145,000 pictures of him and his, but you know, his uncle on their fishing trip together, and you loved all 4 hours of it. Oh yes, you did, right? So, and you like see a picture of him with his dog, and you're like, that's the cutest golden retriever I've ever seen in my entire life, right? Like, and then you see a picture of him with his arm around a girl, and you're like, oh, that better be his sister, right? Like, social media stalking, right? Yeah. The guys do it too, but we're not going to talk about it. Okay, and then you start flirting, naturally, right? Flirting. And then you start texting. Did you hear how deadly silent the whole room went? It's like, she's so funny. She read my mind. Texting. Dun, dun, dun. Right? Did you hear how quiet the room went? Is texting not the most, like, charged word ever? Show me, how many of you like texting? Good for relationships? Bad for relationships? Show me, what do you think? Main campus 5. This girl's like, texting. It's really funny. If I'm hanging out with junior high students, I'm like, what do you guys think of texting? And they're always like, it's amazing. I've had my phone for 2 weeks. I've waited my whole life. It's changed my life. I love it. Right? Like, yes. And you ask high schoolers, and I usually get the like, And then I ask college students, and they're like, just let it die. Right? Make it swift. End it. Right? So texting, should we just leave it with it's charged, right? Okay, and then calling, right? Boyfriend on speakerphone, phone on the pillow like he's there. Okay, good, moving on. Moving on to physically stalking, right? Physically stalking. Everyone's like, oh, follow him around like a puppy dog, right? Like, kind of. I call this lovingly the emoticoaster. And the reason why I call it the emoticoaster is it can kind of feel like a roller coaster. You all been to like an amusement park, right? You've been to like Six Flags or something fun. Do you guys know that feeling where you can like smell the asphalt burning through your flip-flops, right? And you're like hot and wet and angry and hangry and like you have all kinds of emotions, right? And you're like convincing your friends that this 4-hour wait for this ride is gonna be epic and change their life, right? So you got like 3 people that are in with you and you've moved through the line for 4 hours, right? And you just keep talking about how amazing this is gonna be and you finally get to the front of the line and you strap into this ride and you're like, yes, right? And the up the mountain, chink, 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 you're like, right? And then you go to the top and it drops you and your stomach comes up and your head's like, do, 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 do. And if you're a female, you have a permanent hole in the back of your head where your earring dug into your neck, right? It's true. And you know, like you have tears streaming down your face from the wind and this ride just takes you and then you come to this grinding halt and you take one step off the roller coaster and you throw up in front of everyone. And you spend the rest of the day under a shady tree in a trash can wondering why you paid $59.99 for this fantastic experience, right? Right? And your friends stand there and pat your back. Okay, so here we go. Can relationships sometimes go like that? Can the emoticoaster sometimes, you know, move you? This puppy can move in 5 days, it can move over 5 weeks, it can move over 5 years, please Lord Jesus, no, but like, you know what I mean? Like this puppy moves. How many of you have ever watched people in your life ride the emoticoaster? Or maybe you yourself have rode it. You know, what is better, the ride or the anticipation of the ride sometimes? What makes you get over that fear to get on it sometimes is the fact that you just waited in line for 4 hours and thought nothing of anything else but that, right? Okay, eyes right here, right here. I'm not a hater. This whole list, mental stalking, social media stalking, flirting, texting, calling, physically stalking, those are all gonna be parts of a relationship to some degree. Don't walk away from this talk going, oh my gosh, I've done all, like I did all those today, right? Like, you don't walk away from this thinking, oh my gosh, but do you see some potential traps? I call them potential traps, yeah? I'm a visual learner. Any other visual learners in here? Okay, I brought you a potential traps slide. Okay, good, here it is. Mental stalking, it's a one-way relationship. You're building the unknown. Expectations can be too high and it can be creepy. Social media stalking, you're getting into someone's personal life and making assumptions. Wouldn't you rather let him tell you about himself? Flirting, you may be seeking attention or feeling an insecurity or sending mixed messages and it can come across as fake. Don't you want them to get to know the real you? Texting, it can be intimate, misinterpreted, you can rationalize things as no big deal, and it can be addictive. True or false? True slide, right? Calling, you may stay up late and reveal a lot about yourself, and calling and texting can both be very private. And then physically stalking, not just the puppy dog following around, but like you have to be around them. You don't have any fun without them. You do things just because they do. You may change who you are to please them and start going to things just because they are there. It's easy to wrap yourself up in something for the wrong reasons. This is the potential trap slide. When I was in the dorms, when I started watching this all play out, this was something that I kept coming back to. The emoticoaster, the world's idea perfect, and the emoticoaster kept feeding and spinning. And where it was feeding and spinning was straight onto the cycle of use. Those lists are hard for me because I didn't even need a phone to know what it meant to physically stalk a guy and feel like the boyfriend in my life, runaway bride, how do you like your eggs? Whatever he needed me to be is what I wanted to be. And it really did spin me into places that, down dark alleys that I would have never chosen for myself. And it spins a lot of people, myself included, and I know I'm probably not alone in this crowd either. We get, the world's idea perfect and the emoticoaster spins us right onto the cycle of use. I don't have to explain this to you because unfortunately you're gonna know exactly what I'm talking about, the cycle of use. And sometimes people put it this way, men will use women to get sex and women will use sex or their bodies to get love. Right? Men will emotionally manipulate women. They know where our soft spots are. They will do that in order to get what they want, which is sex. And women will take their bodies, their sex appeal, what they know they have and what they know they can offer and what they know they can throw, and they will give that so that they can feel loved or romanced or desired or to feel anything. And men use women emotionally and physically. Women use men emotionally and physically. It's all just this messy cycle, and it just spins. and the Emoticoaster and the World's Idea Perfect feed it. And the only way that we're ever going to be able to deal with the cycle of the use is to call it out. Repeat after me, use. Use. We don't use the word use, do we? Tell me, does this text ever go out? Hey, cute guy, I kind of know. We just had this like 6-hour movie marathon. It was amazing. And I'm just feeling really alone tonight. So I was just wondering if you could just come over for like an hour and we could just snuggle and I could just use you. Would that be okay? Like, does that text go out? Like, maybe not with the word use, but does that text go out? You better believe it, right? How about this one? Like for the men, you know, like, okay, like cute girl, I kind of know. Like, I just looked at porn for a couple hours and like jumped on social media and looked through all your pictures. And like, I just want to use you for 20 minutes tonight. Would that be okay? Like, does that text ever go out? Worst pickup line ever, right? Like, no. But does that text go out? You better believe it. But what is missing? The word use. There is not a single person in this room, not a single person in this room that would ever want to use someone emotionally or physically. But it happens all the time. And it usually happens under the disguise of the word love. Amen? Close your eyes for a minute. Everybody just close your eyes for a quick minute. I want you to think about a time in your life where you were used, either emotionally or physically, and you knew it. Or how about a time in your life where you used someone else, either emotionally or physically, and you knew it? Or maybe it was a time in your life where you watched your best friend be used, either emotionally or physically, and you knew it. Or a time in your life where you watched your best friend use someone else, either emotionally or physically, and you knew it, and you couldn't or you didn't do anything about it. Okay, you can open your eyes. Everybody take a deep breath in and let it out. Those are four of the heaviest questions that I could ask you or that you could ask me, because there is not a single woman in this room that hasn't been used either emotionally or physically or both. And it is a lie from the pit of hell for you to sit here and think that you're the only one that's struggling with this. We are in this together. The cycle of use affects us all. And the only way that we're ever going to be able to get through this together is to call it out for what it is. Repeat after me, use. Use. I want you to take your hands and go like this, okay? I'm going to give you two little slips of paper, and they have two of the strongest sentences you will ever hear in your life. And I want you to take these little fortune cookie pieces of paper, and I want you to put them in your back pocket, okay? Repeat after me. I will not let you use me, and I will not use you. Tell me, women in this room, is there anything more romantic, more captivating than having a man, notice I didn't say boy, a man look you in the eyes and say, I will not use you. I don't want to use you. Just start fanning yourself for crying out loud, right? Like, are you kidding me? Hi, my Pinterest number and board is 4256. Okay, anyway, like, what? I had a guy come up to me after one of my talks, actually at Benedictine, and it was like a month after I gave this talk, and he's like, Sarah, can I talk to you for a minute? And I was like, yeah. We were walking, and he said, I just want you to know that after your talk, he's like, about a week later, I found myself in a really, really tough situation, and I was about to make a really poor life choice with this girl. And your stupid voice came into my head, and I looked at her, and I said, I can't use you. Like, I don't want to use you. And I can't let you use me. And I walked out of that room. And for the first time in my life, I think I know what it means to be a man. And I was like, right? Like, you get it. So I did a happy dance, and I hugged him, and I was like, thank you. Like, you get it. That's the message. That's what I want all of you to know, and that's what I want the men to know. Amen? It's not what he can do for you. It's what he won't put you through. Sometimes that's what love looks like. What do you think that did for that woman in that room that got left in that room? What do you think that did to her interior confidence? Everyone just needs to sit with that for a minute, right? It probably wasn't what she wanted in the moment, but what do you think the long-term effects of that was? You have that power. The men have that power. You have that power. Hold your hand out like this. You hold in your hand the power to build up or to completely destroy the opposite sex, and you know it. And you can use it to love them and to build them up, or you can use it to destroy them. Amen? Repeat after me, use. Use. I will not let you use me, and I will not use you. Do you know this fantastic picture? You guys saw it last night. It's one of my favorites. I have it framed at my house. We've talked a lot about it already last night, but I just want you to look at the way she's looking at Christ. She came to the well. You know her story. She wasn't perfect. She wasn't living the life probably that she even wanted for herself. She had a lot of drama and baggage in her life, just like all of we do. St. Augustine has this phenomenal quote where he says, do you see how deep the well is? We draw deep into the well of fallen desires of man that draw pleasure from dark wells of the world, but never satisfy for long. I know myself. You know yourself. We take our empty jugs and we go to the well and we look over the edge and we see how far and how deep and how dirty the water is. The perfection of the world. And we take our jug and we spend so much time and so much energy and so much effort getting that jug down the well, deep into the well, putting the water in it, pulling it back up. We spend all of our time focused on this dirty water only to consume it, for it to make us sick, for us to long for something else. I give you permission today to put down the jug and all the effort that you're using and that you're all this time you're spending feeding the world's idea perfect. I give you permission to put that jug down. Why? Who sits on the edge of that well? A man who will love you like no human man can. If you try to make any man your God, I did it all the time in high school. I made boyfriends my God. I worshiped them the way we all worship things of the world, right? If you try to make a human man your God, you will crush him because it's not possible. You will hurt him, you will destroy him because you're putting pressure on him to be a God and he can't be that for you, and then you will end up disappointed. And then the cycle will go. Most obsession relationships last about 6 to 18 months and then they start over. You can pick up the jug, you can spend all your time digging down into that well and all that energy and all that worry and all that anxiety, and you can feed all those insecurities, or you can lay your life at the feet of a man who can fulfill your desires like no human man can. When I was in college, I ran so far from the Lord because I wasn't perfect enough for God. I would sideline God. I'd be like, okay, hey, Jesus, what's up? I love you. Like, you're my, like, teddy bear, genie in a bottle, ATM machine, and you are awesome. And, like, I am going to live, like, 1 foot here in the world, and I'm going to give you a pinky toe because you're cool. Like, I love you, right? Like, I like being a youth group girl. It makes me feel good. And I straddled that line, but it was too hard to give up the world. I didn't want to lose the identity that I had built because I had taken that jug and I had dug deep. And I was so afraid of what I was gonna lose. Until one night at a retreat, some friends drug me to this retreat, and I walked into the confessional, and I laid out this entire talk to this priest. I laid out my past. I laid out my mistakes. I laid out the pressure I was feeling. I laid out the insecurities that I felt, that I was never gonna be enough, and that maybe if I just changed this and fixed that and lost 10 pounds, maybe God would love me. Maybe others would love me, maybe my family would love me more. Like, I just knew that if I worked hard enough that I could do this. But I was hollow and I was empty. And I told the priest all of it. I laid out this entire talk to this priest. And he looked me in the eye and he gave me the best dating advice, the best advice I've ever received. One more time, a priest in a confessional gave me the best dating advice I ever received. So if anyone tells you that priests don't know what's up, right? Just like gently drop. Kick. Excellent. Okay, good. So I'm in this confessional and I laid this out and he looked at me and he said, Sarah, this is what I need you to do. I want you to lay everything that you're struggling with, everything that you're dealing with, all of your past, all of your current worries, all of your future. And I want you to put it in a box. I want you to build a box, and I want you to put it in this box, and I want you to drop it off at the feet of someone who can actually do something about it. And I want you to fall into his arms, and I want you to let him love you. And when you're whole, and you've been healing, and you've been striving to be that woman of God that you want to be, when you feel like you're ready, I want you to stand up, and I want you to run with him. When you've been running, I want you to glance to the side and see who's standing next to you, and that's who you're supposed to be with. Changed my life, because for the first time in my life, it just felt like a million bricks fell off my shoulders, and it wasn't about being enough anymore. It was about being loved, and it was about surrendering my life and handing over my control to someone who truly loved me for who I was in all my brokenness. There are many of you out there right now that are like, Sarah, I am damaged goods. I am too far gone. If you knew me, you wouldn't love me because you would know what I've done. You may have lost your virginity. You may have given it away. You may have had it taken away. You may struggle with anxiety or depression or cutting or a million different things. Seriously, shall we go on, right? Like, we all have our list. We all have the things that we're struggling with. But guess what? Our Lord looks at you and he says, not only are you enough, but I want to show you that you're enough. You don't have to try to perfect yourself and then present yourself to me. I want you to bring me everything that you think you're not, and I want you to place it at my feet because I can do something about it. And only I can show you your dignity and worth. Everyone else is trying to show you right now the world's idea of worth. Take that permission and set the jug aside. Amen? This image means a lot to me. Because all of us in this room, we all struggle with different things. And again, the devil wants you to think that you're the only one with a past and that you're the only one with current struggles, that you're the only one with temptations, that you're the only one with the feeling of jealousy or the feeling of vanity or the feeling of pride. Like, the devil wants you to think that you're alone. I tell you right now, you are not alone. We're here together. And there has to be a better way. Amen? Are you ready for a better way this day? Let's do it, right? I call it the 80-20 problem and its big three. So I thought about and worried about these three questions 80% of the time in high school. Who am I going to date and eventually marry? What is he going to do for me? And how is he going to make me feel? And how good can I look doing it? I'm completely outing myself. This is like every decision I made fed these three questions. Am I alone? Probably not, right? Okay, so you see how like 80% of our time, mental energy, obsession, worry, right? Do you see that little 20% up there? What do we do with the little 20%? My prayer is that we switch and we flip these three questions with three other questions. Who do I want to be? What am I living for? And who am I living for? Three questions. I ask them of myself all the time. It directs me. It points me in the right direction. Who do I want to be? What am I living for? Who am I living for? In high school, I would have said, who do you want to be? I have no idea. It terrifies me. Let's not talk about it. What am I living for? My boyfriend. Who am I living for? My boyfriend. Right? That was a quick examination of conscience. What would you answer right now to these three questions? They're big. I even want all the youth ministers and all the chaperones and all the amazing parents out there, like, how would you answer this? Because it's important. Because there isn't an altar switch. You want an altar switch. I wanted an altar switch. What is it? It's this like fantastic, you know, like the altar, you know, on your wedding day, it's like you stand in your beautiful white wedding gown and he's in his handsome like charcoal gray tux that you picked out. And like, you know, like it's this day and you're going to profess your love in front of everyone, right? And you like say, I do. And then you walk around the back of the altar and you flip the switch, right? That little light switch. It's like a light switch in the back and you flip it, right? And you instantly become the woman that you've always dreamt you were going to be. The mother, the wife, the person, just, I'm here. Take me, right? Okay, so like, is there an altar switch? I've checked with many priests. There might be a microphone jack, no altar switch, right? Okay, what are you going to do with these three questions if there is no altar switch? Here's the kicker. Everything that you're doing right now matters. Because I know you want to like boot me off the stage, but your singlehood, the gift of high school and college, it is just that. It is a gift for you. God has carved out this time in your life to figure out, who do I want to be? What am I living for, and who am I living for? And that's going to change the way you live, because every decision you're making right now is taking you steps closer or farther away than the person that you want to be on that day to take vows. Whether you're going to get married and God's called you to that, or you're going to profess vows as a religious woman or a consecrated single, whatever vows God has called you to, these are the three questions you need to ask. Don't waste time on any other questions. Amen? So you see this, right? This is your new motto. Strive to become the woman of your dreams, and you'll attract the man of your dreams. If you are called to marriage, you are worried about being enough. Set it aside. Strive to become the woman of your dreams with Jesus Christ as the rock, anchor, and center of your life. Be that woman that you want to be. If I asked you, who do you want to be? No. When that special guy comes along and falls in love with you, who is he going to fall in love with? That's what this time, this gift to you, is here for you to figure that out. And you have to trust me on the second part. The guy that you're called to be with, if you're called to marriage, is going to be so ridiculously attracted to you for who you are. Not for who you're not, not for who you wish you were, not for who you used to be or who you are 10 pounds lighter. You. And you can have confidence in that. When I was in college, I started learning about, like, all this stuff was starting to click. And I took a class, and this professor came in one day, and he was like, okay, tell me, like, everybody, shout out some virtues. And I was like, oh, patience is a virtue, right? I'm like, I'm sorry, that's all I have. Yeah, okay, good. Public schools, yeah. I had one, but I was really proud of my one. And he's like, excellent, no more. Like, I had nothing else, right? And he put this slide up on the screen. I'm gonna share it with you. Virtue is striving for human excellence. Virtue is forming the habits of knowing and choosing the good and right thing to do. Virtue harnesses and trains your passions and emotions to work towards the good. And virtue gives you the freedom to love. I remember writing it down, and I was like, I got to get me some of this, right? Like, this was the word I was missing in my life. I always feel like chastity and modesty and virtue are like words that are like locked in a vault with Jane Austen, and we're going to free them, right? Let's free the word virtue, amen? What does it mean? How many of you feel like your emotions and passions get you in trouble sometimes, right? Do any of you ever operate under the whole, like human beings kind of work in extremes, right? So like emotions and passions, like we have extremes. One extreme is like, you know what? Like, I've been hurt so much, and my heart's been trampled on so many times. I think I'm just not gonna feel anymore. Like, that just seems like a better option, right? So we like pretend like we don't have emotions and passions, and we push them down and we stuff them away because we don't want to feel. Or we take the other extreme, which is like, wow, like these emotions and passions, like that game is strong, right? Like, I think I'll just let my emotions and passions run the show because it just seems like more fun and a lot more comfortable, right? Do we work in extremes sometimes? Virtue. Check out the slide. Striving for human excellence. Forming the habits of knowing and choosing the good and right thing to do. Harnessing and training your passions and emotions to work towards the good. And virtue gives you the freedom to love. Emotions and passions get a bad rap, right? This slide is really important. I brought the whole slide to you. Emotions and passions are actually good. They give life its fire, its gusto, and its zeal. But you have to be the boss of your thoughts. Emotions and passions happen to you. They are neutral. They're not good or bad. It's what you do with them that counts. Your mind recognizes truth and reality and must not be dominated by your emotions. You can follow your heart sometimes, but don't forget to bring your head with you. This slide, like, oh, baby, where have you been my whole life? Like, when I was in high school, if I would have understood this slide, it would have saved me so much heartache. So much heartache. I'm so excited for you to have these words because, repeat after me, boss of your thoughts. I am the boss of my thoughts. All kinds of like snapping in attitude, right? Like that was pretty snappy. Like, I am the boss of my thoughts, right? Do you believe that? Tell me, when you're walking through life, right? And all of a sudden over here in the distance, you like see a guy and you're like, oh, hey, right? Or like when you see a girl and you're like tempted to be jealous or envious, right? Your temptation to be jealous, your temptation to be envious, your temptation to see a guy and be like, what's next there, right? Like, when you have these emotions and passions that come to you, can you control that? Is that something you choose? Not always, right? What do you get to choose? You get to choose what you do with that, and you get to choose how you prepare your heart for when they enter. One more time. You get to choose what you do with that, and you get to choose how you've prepared your heart for when they enter. Does that make sense? So do you feel like you have a little more power in this game now? I felt like I never had power in this game. It was like, oh, great. What am I supposed to do with that, right? Like, I don't want to feel that. I don't want to be like that. I don't want to have that be my first emotion. Do you have a choice? Yes. Hold your hand out. I have the power over my emotions and passions. Your mind must recognize the truth in reality. Who lives in reality at all times? Okay? Like, we are women. Our imaginations are beautiful. It's a good thing, right? But the devil can sneak in and do some crazy things in fantasy world, amen? He starts with telling you you're not enough, and then he ends with telling you that Jesus isn't enough either. Your mind recognizes truth and reality and must not be dominated by your emotions. You can follow your heart sometimes, but don't forget to bring your head with you. How many of you have ever seen those little memes that say, like, follow your heart, right? I'm always like, okay, that might be the worst advice ever. Like, beautiful, but like, seriously. If I followed my heart, I would just sit at McDonald's and eat fries and shakes and watch my children play on the floor in sweats. Like, that's what I would do because that's where my heart belongs, right? My heart. Okay, we'll go on. Like, let's be honest. If we followed our heart all the time, probably not going to lead us down good paths. Don't forget to bring your head with you. Amen? When I was in college, this was all clicking. So we decided to ask our guy friends, what is the most attractive thing about a woman? And so they got into their man huddle. Have you guys all seen a man huddle, right? Where like guys get in this and they like put their arms around each other's shoulders and they start swaying back and forth, right? And there's typically grunting, right? And I'm sure it smells amazing. So they're over in this like man huddle for 10 minutes and we're like, oh my gosh, this is gonna be so good. Like, what's the most attractive thing about a woman? Because we wanted to know like what they were looking for. What do you want? So they come out of the man huddle and they're like, okay, we got it. And we're like, and they were like, okay, most attractive thing about a woman, holiness and confidence. We were like, I'm sorry, come again. And they were like, holiness and confidence. Even girls that like aren't into their faith, or even guys that aren't into their faith, or like, you know, they say like they want a woman who knows who she is and does the right thing, like holiness and confidence. And all my girlfriends and I were like, wow, thank you. That is deep. Wow, thank you. Okay, great. And we like awkwardly walked out. Like, and I remember we got back to our dorm room and one of my friends like took her coat and she slammed it down. She was like, why'd we even ask? We asked. We don't even know what the heck that means. Like, we don't even know how to be that. Like, watch me, holy and confidence, frolicking, watch me go, like, watch me frolic. Like, I got nothing, right? Like, we had no idea what they were talking about. And so we went back to them and we were like, okay, we're gonna need a few like practical tips and tools, you know, to like could you just tell us a little bit about what exactly that means? Because we all thought we had to just like lose 10 pounds and dye our hair, right? Like, this is a little more complicated. I'm not really sure about this. So they started making this list and they called her the simply irresistible virtuous woman. And they started like listing all of these lists, you know? So we were like, oh, that's so sweet, thank you. Like, well, if you're doing that, we might as well like do it, you know, make you guys a list. So we made the list called the Simply Irresistible Virtuous Man. Theirs was on a napkin. Ours was on a 7-page Excel spreadsheet, color-coded, in preference and level of intensity, right? So anyway, we gave them that out of love. So do you want to see the Simply Irresistible Virtuous Woman? Do you want to see her? Yes? Okay, here she is. She is feminine, she is confident, and she's committed. She's gentle and kind, graceful and sincere, patient and flexible, doesn't gossip, isn't rude, tries to eliminate drama, not create it, poised and modest, open to the needs of others, nurturing and welcoming, joyful and fun. She's confident. She stands up for what is right and seeks the truth. She has courage and is not afraid to confront and help someone. She's genuinely excited for another, not jealous or vain. She speaks with conviction. She's responsible, prudent, humble, and honest, secure, sensitive to the needs of others. She's committed. Her relationship with God comes first in her life. She puts others first before herself. She strives for excellence in all things, in chastity and sobriety, and tries her hardest in academics or her career. She's not led solely by her emotions and passions. She maintains balance and order in her life. She lives a life of charity and service. She's forgiving, trustworthy, loyal, and pure. Okay, everybody in the house, I need you to take a deep breath in and let it out. One more time, deep breath in and let it out. I always tell the men, like, did you notice that we had to do intensive breathing treatments after these lists? Like, women don't look at these lists and go like, oh my gosh, I want to be her. We look at these lists and we're like, I'm not that, I'm not that, I'm not that. I messed that one up at lunch. I'm not that, I'm not that, I'm not that, right? Like, this is stressful and I get that, right? So we took deep breaths and then I want you to repeat after me, striving, striving. Not perfect, because perfect doesn't exist. Striving. There is not a woman walking the earth that is completely all of these things at all times. Let's take that pressure off. Mother Mary's in heaven. The guys missed their chance and they're stuck with us, okay? So there's not a woman that's perfectly all these things at all times. Here's the kicker, everybody, eyes right here. What is actually attractive about this woman is not that she's perfectly all of them at all times, but it is the act of striving. The men tell me it is the actual striving that is attractive, that is simply irresistible. Take that and put that somewhere very deep in your heart. Perfectionism, right? Competition, comparing, that whole game, the world's idea of perfect game, that's not the Lord's list. My guess is it looks a little bit like the screen behind me. We want to fight to strive to be the women on that altar someday. This is your list. And guess what? Bonus points. It's what the men want too for you because you're their sister in Christ. Amen. Repeat after me, striving. Do you want to see the guy, the simply irresistible virtuous man? Yeah. I always ask the women and they're always like, put up the slide, right? I know, and the guys are always like, or not. Like, I feel this is going to be painful, right? It's not painful. It's awesome. Here he is. The simply irresistible virtuous man, he's masculine, confident, and committed. He's masculine. He's a leader, provider, protector, initiator, chivalrous, brave and courageous, gentle and respectful, intuitive and patient, joyful and fun. And if you notice, the confident and committed list are the exact same list as the simply irresistible virtuous woman because we share humanity. Amen? We share humanity. Look at how much we can help each other and build each other up in, right? That's a pretty long list. I always ask the guys, like, is this woman attractive? And it's so good for you to hear them, like, hoot and holler for it. Because this isn't always what men kind of show that what, this isn't always what they show what they want, right? And do the women, do we show the men that these lists are what we want? This is a game changer in the cycle of use battle. If we can build each other up with this, we can change the game. Amen? So our new plan moving forward, right? Know what sends you on the emoto coaster. You know yourself. You know your emotions. You know your passions. You know your past. You know your pitfalls. You know your triggers. Let's be real about it. Let's be aware of it. Emotional virtue, this whole game of chastity, 90% of it is awareness as to what really messes with you. And the other 10% is discipline and self-control. Amen? Like, this is the game. We walk around blind. We don't know what messes with us until we actually say, what's messing with me? Know what sends you on the emoto coaster, yeah? Call out the cycle of use. Repeat after me, use. Use. I will not use you. And I will not let you use me. Take your pieces of paper. Yep. Put them in your back pocket. Promise me that you will pull them out and you will use them. Promise me that they will become like phrases in your life that you use, because there's going to be a time in the next 5 years you're going to find yourself in a tough situation about to make a life choice, and you may have to bust those words out. I want you to have them on the tip of your tongue. Amen? Run to our Lord, lay it all down at his feet this weekend and every day after that. Every morning I wake up and I say, I surrender my life, I surrender my day, I surrender my all to you, Lord. Because I'm a control freak. I'm an eldest child, only girl, control freak. Hi, therapy later, right? Like, I am a control freak. I think sometimes that I can do it better than God. Or I don't want to bother him, so I'll just take care of it, right? That's not how we should think. That is not how we should play this game. He wants you to bring everything that you're struggling with to him and lay it down at his feet this weekend and every day after it. My favorite hashtags are hashtag surrender and hashtag strive. That's just Sarah Swafford 18. Like, that's where I'm at. Like, that is what I work with. You guys, those lists, the simply irresistible virtuous lists that I want you to rock, I want you to strive to become the woman of your dreams, and I want you to rock those simply irresistible virtuous lists. They're my list too. All the moms out in the crowd, all the youth ministers out in the crowd, like, that's their new list too. Am I a better mother? Am I a better wife? Am I a better human being? Am I a better person when I know that list is out there and I take different things and I work on them through the week? I call it the virtue challenge. Like, I mean, striving is ridiculously attractive in all relationships, not just romance, you know, romantic relationships or that kind of relationship, all relationships. Amen? And then protect and respect each other. Last thing, is it hard to be a woman? I'm sorry, is it hard to be a woman? Okay, so it's not just me, right? I want you to look at the women around you. Hey, what's up, girl? How's it going? Heyo. You look good. I love you rocking that thirst shirt. Yeah. Okay, are you ready to take the pledge? Everybody, please raise your right hand. All the women in the crowd, here we go. I promise you, Sarah, from this day forward, I will not make life harder on another woman. Amen. Now look at the women around you and say, I mean it, I mean it, I mean it, I mean it, I mean it. I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you, I love you. I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry, I'm sorry. Okay, right hands up one more time. I promise you, Sarah, from this day forward, I will not make life harder on the opposite sex. Amen. I mean it. I'm going to tell the boys later. Hi, youth group boy. I'm here to not make your life harder. Thank you. Right? I'm for you, baby, not against you, right? I'm going to hand you this list, and I want you to read it just for kicks, right? Like, okay, so if I could go to lunch with you right now, if I could go to coffee with you, if I could go spend 3 or 4 hours with you, I would, because I love you. And I would sit there and I would listen, and I would pour my heart out as you're pouring your heart out, because you don't hear how awesome you are enough. And a lot of you, like myself, come to things, come to life and say, I know everything that I don't want to do, and I know everything that I'm not supposed to be doing, but I don't have a clue what I'm supposed to be doing with myself right now. What am I supposed to be saying yes to? And so Jason Everett told me that I had to take every nap time for 2 years and write all of this down. So I said, okay. So it took me 2 years, but I wrote you a letter. And if I could have lunch with you, if I could go to coffee with you, like, this is what I would say to you. It's called emotional virtue. But basically what it is it's my heart to your heart. Life is hard. Being a woman is hard. Being a guy is hard. Figuring each other out is hard. Knowing your vocation is hard. It's all hard. But we're in this together. And like I said, I don't want you to leave here and walk out of this room feeling like, ugh, I don't know. Like, I don't know how to do this. I want you to take those little pieces of paper, put it in your back pocket. And I want you to put Jesus Christ at the center of your life. And then I want you to take this book and put it in your cute little purse, right? And I want you to take it to adoration, because I want to be that conversation with you. When it's dark and it's not looking good and you don't know where to turn to, I want you to turn to our Lord in adoration and pull out good books. Jason, Jackie, Leah, there's so many people in our church that love you. Whenever I was at the SEEK conference a few years ago, and I gave a talk similar to this for men and women, and it's a Lighthouse CD. So like the book and the Lighthouse CD, it's all there. And then like, I think we need reminders, right? Like, I had a girl come up to me one time and she was like, until today, like, Beyonce was my idol, but after today, like, you're my new Beyonce. And it meant so much to me, because who do we idolize, right? You need to love Jesus Christ. He is your God. There are no other gods. Point yourself towards him. Listen to the voices that love you, like the crazy chick from Kansas, right? My college girls and guys made shirts. This one says, Just Say No to Drama. Because Just Say No to Drugs and drama go together. So Just Say No to Drama, right? This is the one that my girls made this one. It's really cute. Take it to heart. It says, be you to full. There's a difference between jealousy and envy. Jealousy looks at a woman and says, I want what she has. And that doesn't always mean that you're, you know, that's not always a bad thing. It might be like, oh, I really love that about her. I want what she has. I want how she lives her life. Envy is a problem. Envy says, I want what she has, and I don't want her to have it. And I'm going to take it from her so I can have it myself. That's a huge difference. Our Lord wants you to be you. He loves you just the way you are, but too much to leave you there. But you have to be you because you're beautiful. And again, you don't hear it enough. And then this one's my favorite too. It's just appropriate, right? You can't take drama. You can't eliminate it completely out of your life, but can we minimize it? Hold your hand out. You hold in the power of your hands self-control over your emotions and passions. You get to harness them and train them. You get to decide where those thoughts and those emotions and those feelings enter, how you're preparing your heart and mind for that. And you have the complete power over the opposite sex. You can crush them, you can destroy them, or you can build them up as your brothers in Christ. Amen.